Welcome to the Faith Lutheran Church Bible Study, The Triumph of the Lamb, a study in Revelation. Tonight in our Wednesday class, we discuss the second beast from Revelation chapter 13, verses 11 to 18. Let's listen in.
All right, guys, let's pray. Father, thanks for this day. We thank you for the beautiful weather you have given us, for the rain we received yesterday. And Lord, we give you thanks for that gift. And we see some very promising clouds around today, Lord. So continue to give us the rain that we so desperately need here and provide that for us. We thank you for your provision yesterday. Have mercy on us tonight, Lord. Guide us as we study some difficult texts and let your will be done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's do Revelation 13. All right, so let's run a quick review of where we are in the book and get into this tonight. We have a very small amount of verses to get through to finish chapter 13, and I haven't quite done it in either class yet, so we'll see what we do. Quick review, we're in the fourth vision of the book, remember, and in this vision, we've been dealing with this strange dragon who we have said is the
devil.
The devil is the dragon. And in the first chapter of this vision, that's chapter 12, I think we can say there were four phases to the devil's work, okay? First was his effort to devour the baby, which was Jesus. Did he succeed in that? No, why not? What did the baby do? This is actually a very easy answer. Don't overthink this. What did the baby do?
Right.
Norm, overthink it a little. Yes, and... grew up, suffered, died, rose from the dead, suffered under Pontius Pilate, Apostles' Creed stuff, right? Because it's Jesus. And so he rises and goes to heaven, and then war breaks out in heaven. And does the devil win there?
No.
What happens to him?
Cast out.
Cast out to the earth. And here he attacks who? In this vision. The woman who represents?
The church.
The church. And so she attacks the church. Mary, who is the symbolic then of the people of God and the church. And so he attacks the church. And does he succeed in this? No. Remember, the earth opens up and helps the woman. So then he turns his attack on whom? The offspring of the woman. We would say individual Christians. Now, as we go through this then, the attacks he's going to wage on, I would say that this section where he talks about the attack he wages on the church and the offspring of the church, that's probably present tense stuff. Like, that's what's happening right now, okay? And he's going to wage his war on the church, on the people of God, with a twofold attack. And this is the attack of the beasts, okay? The first beast we discussed last week, yes? Okay, and the first beast represents, we said, the political beast. That is, any governing authority, philosophy, theory, theology, maybe not theology, but theory, philosophy, educational system, anything that stands opposed to Christ and his church. Okay, so sort of a secular political beast, if we would say that. I'm beginning to think more and more we don't need to hate that word secular so much, because secular things are good, it's just they're bad when they're opposed to Jesus, see, and so, okay. I always heard this in college, like, do you listen to Christian music or secular music? And I would say, good music. Do as you will with that. But we'll call it the political beast. Any secular power attacking the church, something like this, okay? And then we said it's probably very clearly seen, almost sort of epitomized in the Roman Empire. That's why a lot of the things you're reading about there of that beast sound like what's going on in the Roman Empire. However, this beast will remain until Christ returns, continuing to attack the church. Okay, and so then that leads us into the second beast. And the image I have in my mind here of the dragon, I think I said this to you guys last week, is Mickey Mouse in
Sorcerer's
Apprentice, which is in Fantasia, correct? And so there he is, and he's got his Mickey hat on. Don't tell my kids I called Mickey the devil here. But he's calling forth the sea, and everything's going crazy, all the water. And now he's going to call forth the brooms and the buckets and all this thing. And it's just going to be kind of attempting to create chaos. Mickey does it on accident. The dragon's doing it on purpose, okay? so we can justify Mickey a little bit. But now comes the second beast. The first one has come. Everyone is bowing down to it and following it, and things are looking very bad. And the saints are called to persevere because they will suffer under the tyranny of the first beast, however it may manifest itself. And now you have the second beast. Can someone read to us of the second beast, 13:11 through 18, please? Why don't we do this? Let's do 13. No, we'll go through 18. We'll just read the whole thing and go. All right. Go ahead, Marjorie.
Then I saw another beast coming out of the earth. He had two horns like a lamb, but he spoke like a dragon. He exercised all the authority of the first beast on his behalf and made the earth and its inhabitants worship the first beast, whose fatal wound had been healed. And he performed great and miraculous signs, even causing fire to come down from heaven to earth in full view of men. Because of the signs he was given power to do on behalf of the first beast, he deceived the inhabitants of the earth. He ordered them to set up an image in honor of the beast who was wounded by the sword yet lived. He was given power to give breath to the image of the first beast so that it could speak and cause all who refused to worship the image to be killed. He also forced everyone, small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on his right hand or on his forehead, so that no one could buy or sell unless he had the mark, which is the name of the beast or the number of his name. This calls for wisdom. If anyone has insight, let him calculate the number of the beast, for it is man's number. His number is 666.
Okay, this is the one verse we've all joined the class to figure out, right? The 666 verse. Okay. After this, it's all downhill, which isn't saying much. All right, so then I saw another beast rising out of the earth, and describe this beast to me. What does he look like?
No, I have a question.
Okay.
The number 666, is that the number of incomplete?
We'll talk about that. Okay. Yeah. Maybe, because we haven't gotten there with any other class yet. But yeah. All right. Go ahead. What's he look like? Two horns like what?
A lamb.
Now, when you've been reading this book so far, lambs, good guys or bad guys?
Good.
They're the Jesus guy, right? I mean, it's the big good guy, right? So this one looks like a lamb, but how does he speak?
Yes.
Like a beast, like a dragon.
Like a wolf in sheep's clothing.
Yes. Oh! So far, so good, Dave. You took the words right out of my mouth. Very good. What's that?
I didn't learn the song.
It wasn't that good. Well, you took my comment. So, there you go. It's a wolf in sheep's clothing, right? This is one who looks like a duck, acts like a duck, but talks like a demon. Okay, and so it's not a duck, it's a demon. And so here he comes, looking very Jesus-like, looking very godly, and yet singing the praises of the first beast. I think what we want to talk about here, I think we did this a little bit last week, but it's worth visiting again. What you have here in Revelation in the fourth vision is what we're going to call the unholy trinity. The devil, the political beast, and here I think we want to speak of the religious beast, the ecclesiastical beast. And here's the beast that rises up in the name of the church to sing the praises of the political beast, all to the glory of the dragon. And notice then how these three creatures are operating very much like the uncreated triune God. The Father sends the Son in the power of the Spirit. The Spirit comes and points us back to Christ. Remember, this is the verses a few weeks ago from John's Gospel where Jesus says these words, if I go away, it's good for you. I'm going back to the Father. And if I go, I'm going to send the Spirit to you. And when I send him to you, it's him who's going to testify about me. He's going to point you back to me. All that the Father has is mine, Jesus says. And so the Spirit's going to take from what is mine and give it to you. So that we say this in our delightful Athanasian Creed, something along the lines of, the Father sends the Son, and the Son and the Father send the Holy Spirit. And if we don't say that in the Creed, it's a nice summary of it. The Father sends the Son, and then the Son returns to the Father, and the Father and the Son send the Spirit to point us back to the Son, to the glory of the Father, something like that. That's just, I mean, we don't want to get too technical with that. That's just how the Bible describes it, okay? Why the glory to the Father, not to the Son? It's not the point. The point is this is the way the Bible talks. And so this is what the triune God is doing. They're sending each other. They're pointing to each other. There's sort of this inner connection between them pointing back to each other. Well, you have the same thing here happening with the dragon and the beasts. even if the first beast, as we said last week, is ignorant of its role in all of this, and same with the second beast, the dragon's orchestrating it all. It's the dragon who sends the first beast out to take control of the world, and everyone bows down to worship it. It mocks Jesus, right? The second beast looks like it dies and rises. Now, notice it says it suffers a mortal wound. It doesn't say it actually dies and rises, because it's not actually Jesus. I mean, this language is very important. It's a mockery or a makeup of Jesus. You guys ever read Lewis's The Last Battle? C.S. Lewis's The Last Battle?
Yeah.
All right, there's a great analogy of this in there, where there's a evil little monkey who comes along and finds the skin of a dead lion, and he convinces his knucklehead donkey friend, whose name escapes me, Button or something, I can't remember. Anyways, he convinces the donkey to dress up like the lion and prance around saying he's Aslan. If you remember from the books, Aslan is the big Jesus character. And so he's going to prance around claiming to be Aslan, and everyone's going to kind of come to bow to Aslan, but really it's just this donkey who is aping Aslan. Get it? Because it's the ape who gets him entered. Never mind. All right. So this is what's going on. This is a great picture of what we see here. Here the dragon is setting forth a beast that looks like Jesus and draws people to it so that they bow down and worship it and pray to it and honor it. And notice the language that's used there with the second beast. Authority was given it over every tribe, nation, language, and nation, and all who dwell on the earth worship it. Now, was that authority given to it by God? I don't think so. Because who has God given that authority to? Jesus already. And so this is the demon, the dragon, making a mockery of Christ and drawing people to worship this. Now, the second beast comes along and looks like it's teaching Jesus stuff, but when you listen to it, it's actually giving credence to the beast, the first beast, just like the Holy Spirit comes to point us to Christ. The Spirit is given so that we hear about Jesus. We always say, how do you know you're in a faithful church? Well, are you receiving Jesus? Not do they have a nice light show, or lack of that, but are you getting Christ in the service? If not, go find another church. I hope you're getting Christ here, otherwise that's bad for business. Okay, but so the idea is, the Spirit, if he's working, you're going to be pointed to Christ. Here, where the second beast is working, he's pointing to whatever political or philosophical or whatever thing is in authority at the time and saying, this is what we're going to bow down to. This is the authority. This is the ultimate good. And it's going to probably use Bible verses, and it's going to probably employ good moral theological language, and it's all going to point you away from Jesus. Does that make sense? So I'm trying to think of a good example of this. I think like the one of the great examples is what happens in Nazi Germany with the German state church, where Hitler starts putting himself in charge of who's going to preach and who isn't, and what they're going to say and what they're not going to say. It's very much worth your time, and it's very easy to read, though the book is thick. Eric McTaxis, something like this, the biography of Dietrich Bonhoeffer. Bonhoeffer's life is interesting in and of itself, but what McTaxis does with it is he puts it in the context of Nazi Germany. So I learned a lot about how the church was treated during the time of Nazism. And the church became an instrument of the state. And see, that's exactly what's happening here with the second beast. Here, this church-looking thing is operating in the power of the state. In America, we probably see this when the church starts to look more... So for us, the God we bow to in our day and age is relevance. I mean, it's kind of an ideal, but it's also something we bow to. And so someone says, well, the church needs to be more relevant by preaching less Jesus. You want to say, well, that Jesus is relevant, just not the way you want him to be, right? We need to make the church look more like the culture. And this happens, before we start like conjuring up all of our enemies in our minds, this happens in both liberal and conservative ends of the church. Because then you say, well, the church's responsibility is to make America a Christian nation again. And so, because what really matters is the faith of the nation. And on the flip side, you say, no, it's the responsibility of the church to make sure everyone feels included in love no matter what their sins are. Because what their sins are not really sins. God loves everyone just the way they are, so the church needs to bow to that. And it's just, we're just mixed up on everything. The point is Christ, the law and the gospel, that sinners need to die and be raised to a new life. And if that's not what's happening, then the church is in service to something else, and very often that is the second beast, or the first beast. Does that make sense?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, Marjorie, go ahead.
I think you also see it with churches trying to persuade, suggest, whatever word you want to use, their congregation, how they should be voting on certain issues. And I can remember that happening way back as long ago as in the late 60s, that they would tell people, because I can remember it was a Presbyterian church, so forgive them for that, but I remember that there were churches, and I think that there still are churches that tell their congregations, you should be voting this way on such and such an issue. And that, to me, is kind of bordering on really going into the realm of what should be the political realm and should be separate.
You're starting to play the political game, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah. I, you know, that's an interesting thing.
I think that's exactly the opposite.
Go ahead. Why?
Well, that's the church trying to influence the political system. Is the opposite from the political system influencing the church.
Yeah, and I would say, yeah, I think that's right. And I think that can work. I don't know if either of those are good things. Although, I don't think it's wrong for the church to try and have some influence in the political system.
I don't think it's wrong either.
No.
I don't agree with the analogy.
Doesn't it depend on what the issue
church.
Is?
Sure, absolutely it does. Like, I don't think the church has a whole lot to say on, like, school vouchers, for example, or something like this. But the church probably should have something to say about abortion or those things. You know, I think that's something where the church says, this is not a sort of neutral issue. This is a life God created, and so we have to take a stance on this.
I think the church can speak to issues and let the people connect the dots.
Absolutely.
You don't have to name names, but you can certainly talk issues.
Although we had, this is very interesting, you're not going this time. Dave Anderson is going. We have a pastor's convention, a district convention coming up. And a few years back, someone put in a motion to call President Obama out on his stance on abortion. And I think the floor committees decided to not put it into the agenda because Obama's name was used. Or they put it in, but they removed Obama's name, saying we shouldn't use names. And the guy who submitted it stood up at the microphone and said, well, then we have to get rid of all these things in the New Testament where they use names. He's like, well, I guess there's that. And so, you know, I mean,
they could have referred to Babylon.
Yeah. So, I think there's... I don't think it's wrong to say the church should be involved in the political process, especially in certain issues. But at the same time, I think it's okay for us to say something like, you know, within the church, you can have differing political views. And Democrats and Republicans can both sit at the altar together. But that's a different thing than saying this one issue is something we can't talk about. And I do think it's, you know, I wish more Missouri Synod Lutherans were involved in the political process. I think it would be a good thing. I think it's good when our people are involved in the culture. It just is. Because it does gain influence and it does have a positive impact. It's not going to save society. But it's not a bad thing to be working for the good of the community. And not in the name of the church, but in the name of what's...
Every congregation is comprised of private citizens who have a responsibility to vote.
Sure. That's right.
The best guy of conscious I know is from the church.
That's right. And I think it's right for the church to say, I do think, though, you're on the right track where you can't say, so therefore Christians will vote for...
No. But,
and that's a dangerous move. Go ahead, Tom. All right, Joyce, you had your hand up first, and then Tom?
Isn't the church's responsibility to preach Christ?
Yes.
What is in the scripture? And if society is trying to tell the church that, no, you're misinterpreting, you know, this is really okay, as in gay marriage or gay lifestyle, that is spelled out in the scripture that Jesus does not condone that.
Right.
So the church has no business going along with that.
Correct. Yeah, and should say so, should say as much.
Exactly.
Yeah. That we're not going to do this because of these reasons.
That is what our responsibility
is. Yeah, that's right. To preach the gospel and to preach the word, even to the culture. I mean, it's hard to say, like, Oh, what's Jefferson's thing, the wall of separation? That's not actually in any official document or something like that.
That's a twist off the Establishment Clause.
Right, which is not actually in the Establishment Clause. Is that correct?
Correct. But they use they claim the Establishment Clause as backing up that falsehood.
And isn't it true? I mean, even Jefferson, with that wall of separations, comments were not that the Christian cannot involve himself in the political process, but rather that the state can't tell the church what to do.
State shall establish.
Right. So I mean,
can't establish a church. It's been twisted.
Right.
And removed.
It's one of the reasons why they came here in the first place, because of the Church of England, the state church.
Yeah. That's one of my favorite things, though. Is the nice thing about those guys who came over, they didn't want it to happen again until they got their own little colony and did it to the people they were opposed to, which is why I think Jefferson's work is actually very good. And I think Jefferson, even with that wall of separation line, was just saying the same thing, but that itself has gotten twisted. Go ahead, Tom. You got something to...
There was a news item this evening that televangelist is... They have a fund that he's starting, and they actually justified this, to buy a G520 or 560 something.
Yeah.
$65 million.
Creflo Dollar, yeah.
$65 million. Yeah. And there was a man who came on and that actually said, the old plane is no good anymore. We need to get a new airplane.
Mm-hmm.
$65 million.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know why? His line, I heard it was, well, look, I use this plane to do ministry. So I need this plane to fly. And you think, well, for $65 million, you could probably get a ticket on United and help the people you're flying to see.
Actually, first class the rest of his life.
Yeah.
You can fly every day.
Yeah.
For
$65 million.
Long past the lifespan of the airplane.
That's right. It's just disgusting.
But
I'm not sure why you brought it up.
Because it's a priority. It's what a congregation is being told is important.
Mm. Yeah. Mm. Okay. Great.
That's what they're serious about this.
Yeah.
They even have the funds called G520 or whatever they have, stupid airplanes.
Yeah. And so Jesus is now no longer the message of the sermon or the thought that in someone's mind when they go to the church. It's funding pastors' plane.
Right.
That's right.
Hey, the messenger. He's got to go with lunch.
I personally think that faith should buy a Cessna 120.
I'd be fine with the BMW. I'd be fine with the BMW. I'm a humble guy, Tom.
A Cessna 120 is a shame.
Yeah.
It's a bottom line.
Thank you. That's very nice of you.
Ultra
thank
line.
You. Go ahead. I'll draw a flight to Camarillo and back.
Kind of like what we were saying this morning, this is an issue that won't go away because this isn't the first time that this has been brought up in the media. So here.
Which one is this?
This gentleman.
About Creflo Dollars. Yeah.
Because I think a couple of months ago is when they first started talking about it.
Yeah. Would be a good time to go back to Revelation.
Yeah. That's going to take us a little bit off track there. Yeah.
Anytime there's an issue.
Marjorie really wants to talk about our argument this morning.
Anytime there's issues that can paint a Christian in a less than good area, the media will play it up. Anytime a Christian falls or is in the news, the media likes it. They jump all over it.
Sure.
And I think they really want, a lot of the media, they really want to say, well, look at these hypocrites.
Yeah.
So, they'll play that stuff up.
We do a good job of getting ourselves there too at times, though. So, yeah. But I mean, you're right. You're absolutely right. And that's that is a little far afield from what we're actually getting at right now. But yeah, I think you're on the right track with that. Okay. So this beast comes along and he points to he does the work of the Holy Spirit for the sake of the second beast, first beast. He's saying second beast, but it's the first beast of the second dragon. Oh, forget it. Okay. It exercises all authority of the first beast in its presence and makes the earth and its inhabitants worship the first beast with whose mortal wound was healed. It performs great signs, even making fire come down from heaven to earth in front of the people. And by the signs that is allowed to work in the presence of the beast, it deceives those who dwell on the earth, telling them to make an image of the beast that was wounded by the sword and yet lived. All right, so it's going to do divine stuff. Is this literal fire it's going to call down from heaven? Maybe, but I think more along the lines here is we have an apocalyptic picture of what Jesus described when he said in the last days, there will be false teachers and they will perform signs and wonders. Yeah. They'll do stuff that looks Jesus-y. Don't listen to them. It's not me. You will know when it's me. And oh, yeah, sorry, Sheldon, we talked about this last week. Like, we will know when Christ comes back. We will see it. It won't be a question. It will be loud and noisy and lots of... you'll see Abe Lincoln walking down the street and you'll be thinking, well, that's odd. You know, I mean, this is going to be a lot of resurrection stuff going on. It won't be a question of whether it's Jesus or not. Okay. Let's see. What else do I want to get at here? He performs these signs. They make this image. Last week we talked about this Caligula character who was a Caesar and looks like he was about to die but came back to life and got quite a following, was given sort of divine reputation because of him coming back to life. He's also known for having set up, or attempted to anyway, set up a statue of himself in Jerusalem. You know, you're not supposed to do that in the mind of the Jews. Set up a statue to a god besides Yahweh. It's a breaking of the first commandment. It's kind of a big deal. So, there is this attitude of, look, he's going to come in and set up statues to the first beast in the place of worship, something like that. Rob Phillips mentioned this morning, and I thought this was interesting, the thing that's kind of started the massive Jewish revolt in AD 67 was Rome taking a statue of Zeus and setting it in the temple. And there were little things that they made to look like they were flying around the head of the statue of Zeus, and the statue was made to speak and all of this kind of stuff. Well, here it says that it was allowed to give breath to the image of the beast, so that the image of the beast might even speak and might cause those who would not worship the image of the beast to be slain. In the ancient world, it says the belief in speaking and wonder-working statues was a well-established one in the ancient world. So there's a guy in the 6th century, so a number of centuries after this, but still familiar with this era, named Andreas. And he said during the reign of a guy named Apollonius, we'll call him Apollonius, that spirits in witchcraft frequently spoke through images and statues and trees and water, as well as through Apollonius, and through other demons, and I suppose through dead bodies as well. And so there was witchcraft and sorcery that would go on to make it look like these statues were talking. Was it real? Were they actually talking? Was it all conjured up? Who knows? Doesn't matter. Was it spiritually created? Potentially. Why not? But that doesn't matter a hill of beans, because it's all pointing away from Christ, and it's giving glory to the first beast. And so that's why you look away from it. Think of, someone brought this up on Sunday, I thought this was helpful. You also want to think of Pharaoh. When Moses goes to talk to Pharaoh, do you remember the sign God gave him to show Pharaoh? He's going to remember.
It's a snake.
Snake, yeah. What was the snake to do?
Well, he turned his staff.
Staff turns into the snake, right? And he picks it up. So Moses does this, and then Pharaoh says, I've got magicians too, and they come and they do the same thing. And then God turns the Nile into blood, and then here comes Pharaoh's guys, and they turn water into blood. And then God sends all these frogs, and then the guys make the frogs appear. And so they're mocking God. I mean, it's one thing to be God and make millions of frogs appear in Egypt. It's another thing to be a magician and say, look, I just happened to pull one of these millions of frogs out of my pocket, right? I mean, like, it's clearly not a miracle on the same level, but it still looks pretty fancy. And look, my guys can do what your God does. And so that kind of stuff going on.
If you read Moses' snake, eat the other snake.
Yeah. Oh, you win. Yeah, Ron. All right, so let's do a little bit of there, the glory share. That's right. The snakes ate the other ones. That's right. That's right. Good. I think he got it from Charlton Heston, but we'll say he read Exodus and give him credit for that.
Who was Aaron?
Who was Aaron?
In the movie.
Aaron.
You got it. That's a star.
Denzel Washington?
No, John Carey.
Jim Carrey?
John Carey.
I don't know who that is. Okay.
Keith Carradine's father.
Oh.
Oh, yeah.
You have also...
David Carradine's father.
Him too?
Kung Fu. The Kung Fu guy.
Oh.
It was his father.
Oh, okay.
really old.
Yeah, no, that's great. I mean, if I don't know any of these people, that's on me.
She's the Undertaker just about every other Western day.
Is that right? All right.
Great character.
Oh, all sorts of trivia.
So the idea here, though, the big idea is that the third thing we're dealing with here, the second beast, represents the world's religious systems which align themselves with secular powers in an effort to destroy the church and her witness. And the church will expect to suffer as a result of it. So that's what we have going on here. Okay. Anything else I want to get at with this through that verse? No, I think that's pretty good. Any questions on this so far? Okay. That can't be right. Good heavens, we have 45 minutes. I don't have anything else to say. It's not true. Also, it also causes all, both great, small and great, both rich and poor, both free and slave, to be marked on the right hand or the forehead. Real quick, I do have one other thing. I just came to me. I've mentioned to you guys before that I write for a blog called The Jagged Word and Read With Care. Today, one of the guys on there, who's a Missouri Synod pastor, but he's also, you know, sort of a closet papist, wrote an article. It's not really in the closet if he's writing a blog about it.
The door open.
Yeah, the door's pretty wide open at this point. Yeah, he wrote a blog about how the Lutheran Church needs to reconsider the papacy. Which is very, I'm sure it's fascinating indeed. I wrote, we all make fun of each other in text messages, and I texted him saying, that's funny, because I'm teaching on Revelation 13 today, and that's about the Pope, too. It's just... Because his whole thing is, he says, the Pope is the one guy in the world who has the platform and the ability to create unity within the church, and so I sent him this verse which says... He will cause everybody to receive the sign of the beast on their foreheads. And I say, talk about unity. But I think, you know, in the Reformation, the Lutherans, we get made fun of a little bit for this. But in our confessional documents, we actually say that the Pope is the Antichrist. And whether that, and I say, well, see, obviously he wasn't, because Jesus hasn't come back, so the Pope can't be the Antichrist. But if you define the Antichrist as only that really bad, ugly guy at the end of the world, okay, fine. But if you define the Antichrist as any sort of one who comes in the name of Jesus and turns people away from Jesus, he actually fits the bill quite well, especially when you read here the second beast, who sits on the throne of the church and preaches a gospel that is no gospel at all, according to St. Paul, and turns people to pray to Mary and all sorts of other things. Now, look, this is all very Bible-y stuff. Mary's very important. We believe in a lot of good moral stuff. I mean, no one can really beat the Catholics when it comes to ethics and all of these things. And it all sounds very good, and he's like, here's a nice sheep with two horns, but he speaks things that are not the gospel. Are we going to still say the Pope is the Antichrist? Well, in a sense, I don't have a problem saying that, even if he's a super nice guy. If he's turning people away from faith alone in Jesus, we have a significant issue. And if he's using his papal power to do that, then yeah, it is in fact a problem. Does this mean all of your Catholic friends are marked by the beast? No, it doesn't mean that. But it does mean that you have to be very aware of the things he's saying. Because just because he looks good in the media, see, here we are again, doesn't mean... He's going to be preaching Christ. Go ahead, Tom.
Yeah. I mentioned it once before, and I don't recommend anybody read the book, but there's a Mormon publication called The Great Apostasy.
Sure, yeah.
And in that book, they detail, in the historic references, mm-hmm. What exactly the papacy went through mm-hmm. In like the 400s, the 700s, 800s, something like that. Mm-hmm. And honestly, if you can read that book and still believe in the Pope at all, okay, or any kind of papal succession or any of that sort of stuff, you're a better man than I am.
Yeah.
Because it totally convinced me, okay, yeah, so the church fell away, you know, but the word didn't fall away,
right.
Just the church fell away.
Yeah, yeah, and
the Catholic Church fell away.
Yeah, and I think that's the right way of saying it. I think the church has always remained, Jesus promises it would, despite her efforts. You know, I mean, that might be a way of saying it. Good. Well, now we have a good Mormon recommendation. If you want something a little more Lutheran, I do recommend the Book of Concord, as I always do, but Philip Melanchthon does some of that work in there. And Luther's got quite an article on it somewhere that I've got to find, where he kind of traces the history of the popes as well. And but Melanchthon just goes from the Bible and compares what the Bible says to what's going on and says, look, this is a problem. So the document is called, the Book of Concord, there's something called the Small Called Articles, and at the end of that is a little treatise on the power and primacy of the Pope. It's worth reading. It's worth spending your time on for a little bit. And just to point this out, to say, we see this sort of thing manifested all the time. When the church decides to take its business away from preaching Christ to the world and focusing on more political matters. Now, that's an interesting, because this is exactly what the Pope, especially in the 16th century, was doing, where you have the popes who are excommunicating people, and I'm sorry, the popes who are executing people and the state excommunicating. I mean, things are backwards. Things are not going the way they should, and the two beasts have begun dancing with each other. And so you can see why the Lutherans would get up and preach Christ and then be burnt at the stake and say, hey, maybe he's the Antichrist. Like, it kind of looks like that, because we're being killed for preaching Jesus. Make sense? Mm-hmm. Okay? All right.
How do you even begin to turn your family and friends that are professed Catholics that what they're hearing is wrong?
By talking about Jesus only. And I think you taught Christ. Because here's the thing. In the Catholic Church, they still have the Bible. And Catholics, some of them even know Bible verses. Who knew? And some of them don't, and that's fine. I think we might be able to make the same argument for our own congregation here. But this was Luther's contention was, they would all come for Luther and say, if Luther's right, then there hasn't been a church for 1,400 years. Which is actually the Mormon argument, that there was no church until Joseph Smith came along and restored it. And Luther would always say no, and what Tom just said. So, you're the Luther today. Nicely done. Luther comes along and says, no, the word was there, and where the word is, there's faith. He's right. Maybe the scholastics and all these great teachers and popes and all this were going in a bad direction, but the people were still baptized. The word was still given. And they still clung to Christ as they were dying.
God was still faithful.
That's right.
Good. The whole time.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right.
God remained faithful even if we didn't.
Think of, yes, great. Good use of that passage. Very good.
You got another star?
Maybe.
No squeaker.
Think of Ezekiel. Elijah. When he says, I'm done, I'm the last one. All the people have abandoned you, there's nobody left. And God says, look, I've kept 7,000 for myself. Settle down. I actually am still faithful to my covenant. People still believe. Of course you still have that. But the idea there, Sheldon, then my answer to you is, talk about Jesus. And if they bring stuff up, say, we don't actually believe that, and here's why, and figure out why they believe that and what they believe. But point them to Christ, because I don't think, I think if you were to say to a lot of Catholics, your doctrine, it actually makes you think Jesus isn't sufficient to save you, that you've got to do something, that you've got to trust something else, that there's more that needs to be done, and that Jesus didn't actually finish it on the cross. For example, purgatory. You guys believe in purgatory, but the reason you believe that is because you don't think all of your sins have actually been paid for, and there's more badness in you that must be purged before you go to heaven. In other words, that Jesus is insufficient. And if they start to argue with you on that, I think you've got the Bible on your side and you can do that work there. But the big problem with Rome is the insufficiency of Christ. It's just the big issue. I could care less if we have... Well, I don't care less, but let's say the Pope becomes Lutheran. That it happens. That'd be great. And you would have a papal hierarchy with Lutheran doctrine, fine, no big deal, because we've always said church structure doesn't really, whatever. And if he does convert to Lutheranism, fantastic, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Well, we're back in union with that church. But he's not, because he doesn't think Christ is sufficient. So let's talk Christ, okay? All right. Good. We got to get our comments on the Pope in there. Okay, so, and it causes all, both small and great, both rich and poor, both slave and free, to be marked on the right hand or the forehead. Now, here's where everyone freaks out, like, oh no, this is my social security number, or this is barcodes in my hand, or whatever this might be. I think what you have here is a mock or a mockery of or an aping of baptism. Let's look at the theology and the scripture before we start to try and figure out what the mark of the beast is. The idea here is, remember we talked about this before, that God has sealed his own. Those who belong to him, he's marked as his own. Kind of like in those days when you had a slave, you would mark them as your own. And it sounds awfully crass to us, but if it's Jesus who's marking us, it's kind of good news. It means we belong to him. Okay? And here it's saying, nope, someone else is making them slaves to them. And so the mark of the beast then is a way of indicating that they are not followers of Christ, but something else. And now, is it a literal sign that they'll get burned into their foreheads? I doubt it. I don't think so. Is it a computer chip they put into your hand one day? I don't know, maybe, but either way, I would recommend not getting the computer chip put into your hand. That doesn't seem like a smart move to me. It's probably cell phones, and you're all hosed. I don't know. But I think instead of trying to figure out what is the specific marking here, more to the point is that these are those who do not belong to Christ, that they are ones who have gone the other direction and been marked in a different way. Though this does become interesting, so that no one can buy or sell unless he has the mark, that is the name of the beast or the number of it, of its name. Okay, so the mark of the beast is like a... In the ancient world, it looked like an apple with a little bite taken out of it. And it was put on all the technology, and I'm just saying. No. In those days, in the first century, if you were to go to the market and try and shop, you had to pay an idol. So in other words, if you went to the Apple store... That was not on purpose. If you were to go to the Apple store, you had to pay the Apple God as well as the person selling you the apples. Now, why would you do that? Well, if you're a pagan, this makes a lot of sense. If the Apple God's making a lot of money, the Apple God is happy. And when the Apple God is happy, he gives more apples. It's just good business with the gods. It makes a lot of sense. And so that's what it took to go shopping in the marketplace. So you couldn't buy or sell unless you were worshiping the other gods. And so the Christians found themselves in a position where you couldn't just run down to the mall for stuff. So this is perhaps why you see such a push in the first century to make sure that everyone is taking care of everyone else. And you'll see this in our sermon series through 2 Corinthians. There's a church in Macedonia, I think. And Paul says, those guys are poor as dirt and they're giving all their money to help you, to help other churches. You guys are wealthy. You ought to be giving your money to help other churches also. And we already think, oh, look, it's just communism. No, it's not communism. It's the people of God taking care of each other. And Paul says, because one right now you're rich and they're poor and they need your help. And one day you may be poor and they may be rich. And so they can return the favor to you. But the idea is in the church we take care of each other because we can't go shopping at the grocery store. We've got to take care of ourselves. No one else will do it. Does that make sense? And so it's a matter of loving your neighbor here. And so this is, I think, really quite pertinent when they say, you know, you don't take the mark of the beast. Well, if I don't take the mark, if I don't go down and pay the idols, if I don't do the things that the state is making me do, I don't eat. Right. So the church, you need to start taking care of one another. And that kind of thing.
Are increased when we share.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Very good.
So this revelation is something that was going on in the past.
At the time. And will continue to happen. I mean, this is... I mean, you can see this kind of thing happening throughout history. I hate to keep jumping from Rome to Nazi Germany, but have you seen Sound of Music, for example? In Sound of Music, they all greet each other with the Heil Hitler kind of deal, except for the Von Trapp guy. He's always like, you know, like that is kind of great. But there's that symbol that they know they belong to each other, and they all have the swastika, which reminds them that they belong to each other. There's a mark that they have to distinguish themselves. And so this is basically saying if you're going to take the mark of the beast and align yourself with those things that are opposed to Christ, that's bad news. All right? Does that make sense? I mean, we've always come up with all kinds of things. I think at one point it was the Social Security number was the mark of the beast. And I've heard someone say, well, it's www because that equals 666, so the internet's the beast. I may be more inclined to think that than I used to. You could kind of fit anything in there, but basically the idea is if you are following a church that is pointing you to a power that is not Christ, you are on the team of the beast. Yeah? Okay. All right. Let's see. So the mark, anything else I want to say about that? Yeah, okay, good enough. Yep.
Does that whole idea of that you just expressed,
yeah,
does that extend to theological necessities? What I'm thinking in particular is like speaking in tongues,
mm-hmm.
for instance. There's a church that if you don't speak in tongues, well, then you don't have the Holy Spirit.
You're not actually. You know.
Are they missing the mark on Christ then altogether? And is that what you're talking about there?
I would say they're missing the mark on Christ. I don't know if I'd go so far as to say that they are operating as the second beast. Mainly because I'm not comfortable enough with exactly what's going on here to make that jump. Because I would also say that they are not necessarily out because they say that. Though I do think it's a bad doctrine.
Well,
go on. Why would you wonder?
Well,
thank you, Ron.
At a service... There were people that were speaking tongues, and there were people that were interpreting. And if you didn't either interpret or speak in tongues, people kind of want to know, well, what are you doing here?
Yeah.
Why are you here?
Yeah.
You know. Now, that was their service. It wasn't like they had a service during the morning, and then that night they did that.
Mm-hmm.
That was their service.
Yeah. No, that's the way we did it in the Lutheran church, right? We had our normal service in the morning, and then pastor had his tongue-speaking team come over at night, which is just as dangerous. And so then everyone was expected to be speaking in tongues to demonstrate they were saved. Yeah, because there's that great text in Acts which says, you know, Peter sees them speaking in tongues, and he's, oh, look, they received the Spirit just like we did.
But in each case, there was a purpose behind it, and it was for the edification of those.
Always.
In the Bible,
yes.
And so what the Lutherans say with this one, and I think this is helpful, is that there's a constant danger in the church known as enthusiasm. Enthusiasm means to look at the God within. It doesn't mean to be happy, excited about, right? It doesn't mean to be happy that the Rockies just have taken two of three from the Cardinals. Like, that's not what it means, though I'm enthusiastic about it. What it does mean is to look within yourself to find the Spirit, or to look within something other than the Word to find Christ. And so the enthusiasts are found both in the institutional way, where the Roman Church says, our Pope tells you what the Spirit means, so you have to listen to him. He's the authority. In the more Pentecostal and Anabaptist movements, the look within is to spiritual gifts or something like that. So if you don't have these things happening in your life, you therefore do not have Christ. And you can only know your assurance of Christ is found within. Assurance in the Roman Church is found within the Pope. And our response to that is always, no, the Scripture alone and the Word alone give us assurance. So how do I know I'm saved? Because I was baptized and I was told your sins are forgiven. There in that word, outside of myself, God worked on me. And so I cling to the word, not to what I say or do. And so if we want to say that the political beast operates in a way that says, one of the ways the political beast can offer is by saying, well, you know, the word isn't enough, and so we're offering you this other philosophy or program. Then the church comes along and says, ha-ha, we're on board with that. That's how you know. This was happening, by the way, in Corinth. So in Corinth, Paul has this whole section on speaking in tongues. Because the religion, the ancient pagan religions all spoke in tongues. It was what they did. And so they all believe that if that's what all religions do, the church ought to do that as well. And now Paul can't come in and say, nope, speaking in tongues is a bad thing, because we all kind of know the story of Pentecost. Like, it actually serves a purpose. But within the pagan religions, it was pointing to something away from Christ. And so Paul says, if you come in and you're speaking in tongues and no one knows what's going on, you're wasting your time. Prophesy, which is not some big fancy way of speak about the future. It's preach Jesus. That's what prophesy means. There's far more edification for teaching and preaching than there is from a whole church speaking in tongues, because nobody knows what's going on, and you all feel great, but it's just chaos. And God's not a God of chaos, but a God of order. And there he's talking about how a worship service is supposed to run. See, very interesting. Not kind of fly by the seat of your pants enthusiasm, but there's an order here, so that, Paul says, if you're going to have to speak in tongues, set time aside for it. The Spirit's not just going to fall on people. Very interesting stuff. And so if someone comes along and says, no, the way we know the Spirit works is because there's a bunch of chaos and everyone's saying different things and people are falling down and being slapped on the head and all this kind of stuff, like in the Pentecostal churches, that's pointing to something besides the promises of Christ for our assurance. And so is that the work of the second beast? Kind of, I guess. Anything to point away from Christ. Though here I think specifically it's dealing with the happy marriage between the church and the state in a dangerous way, to where the state becomes Jesus and the church bows to that. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
That was a heck of an answer right there. I'm sorry. I don't think I breathe. Yeah.
If we got into theological discussion, I would agree with her 100%. She was right on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in terms of the work of Christ.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so yeah.
Man, she had to cut one wild service.
Yeah, yeah. Good, Marjorie.
I was just, because I was trying to find where it was, that they talk about the various gifts. And I know what you're talking about, because I've been to a couple of churches where you're right. You do wind up kind of feeling like you're funny if you're not doing what they're doing. And you kind of feel a little bit left out or something. But by the same token, it strikes me that they're, for lack of a better term, cherry picking. They're only choosing certain gifts that they feel that are ones that you're supposed to be given.
Mm-hmm.
And yet the passage that's talking about that talks about all sorts of different
all sorts
gifts.
Of gifts, that's right.
And they're choosing to kind of ignore that part.
Yeah. They're also choosing to ignore, like, they'll appeal to Acts an awful lot. They're choosing to ignore the function of tongues in Acts, not just that people spoke in tongues, but the function of the tongue. So it was always in a language people understood in a way that benefited others. It wasn't, have you ever watched the tongue preachers, they're and the Lord said, hush, ba 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 ba, hush, ba 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 ba. What? Like, what are you doing that for? Like, but that's the Spirit moving, right? And people are worked up, and they're all kind of into this third thing. And that's not at all what it looked like in the New Testament. It just wasn't. And I think we also have to have a healthy level of, you know, I'm not really sure exactly what that looked like in Corinth. I'm not exactly what it looked like to have tongues in their service. And so I'm not going to make a doctrine of it, because I can't say this is what tongues is you know, the Holy Roller Street down the church, therefore that's what it was in the first century. No, that's reading your own thing back into it. And quite frankly, that's not the right way to do it. We just don't know. The tongues served a purpose for a time. There's some people who say tongues have ceased. There's a big fancy term for them. And I kind of sympathize with them. I'm not entirely going to buy in, because there's nowhere in the Bible that says there's no more tongues. Except in 1 Corinthians 13, where it says where tongues cease, but I think it's talking about something else. You know, I don't know how we got on tongues, but I just don't think... thank you, Tom. Good. I don't think it does ultimately do the same thing the second beast does by pointing you away from Jesus, taking your assurance out of the Word into something else. Go ahead, Ron.
Did the Tower of Babel... when the people went out to speak different tongues.
Yeah, and it was part of the curse, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's actually one of the beautiful things about Pentecost Sunday, is it's a reverse of Babel. Suddenly everybody's understanding the word again in their own tongues. And so there's a unifying thing taking place. Like God is undoing what happened at Babel, which is kind of a cool thing to think about.
Well, the Pope talked to the beast today or yesterday. Mr. Putin.
Jeez. I saw that on the news. I was going to text my buddy Graham about it, but I decided not to. Putin's not the beast. Gorbachev was, because he had the mark on his head. Okay.
Did you know he came to Christ?
Yeah, well, that's good to know.
His mother had been working on it for half his life.
That's cool. That's good. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
All right.
You don't have to worry about a mark pollution.
Yeah, I don't think it's something to like freak out over. I mean, I think there's, I don't need the Bible to tell me that if the state wants to come in and mark me with something to decide whether or not I can purchase things, I got an issue. Like, obviously that's a problem, right? And we as Christians will say, okay, now I'm worried about something, and that's fine, because I think the beast can manifest itself in that way. You think about Nazi Germany, for example. The Jews all got marked with something. That wasn't the mark of the beast, but it was to show, like, you have this mark. You are now out. I mean, we'll say that again.
Ostracized.
You're ostracized, right? You, we're not going to do commerce with you. That sounds very similar to what you have going on here.
But it's just the opposite. My footnote says that Satan marks his followers, so the ones that don't have the mark are the ones that are obviously following Christ.
Yeah.
And he will persecute them.
Right. And again, I think what we want to keep, the constant theme here is the aping of God, the devil mocking God. And so God seals his own. Like, we've seen that language, right? God has sealed his own. He's marked them. As, I don't know if it uses the language of mark, but it sounds a little more royal. I think it talks in terms of a seal. And here, the beast is like marking them. So it's a less than. It's still trying to make them look like they're doing God stuff, but it's a less than thing. It's just the way the devil marks you when you do not belong to Christ or something, I guess. Go ahead, Ron. Yeah.
Aren't we marked at baptism?
Yes, that's right. So I would say this is like the anti-baptism of the text. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, the next time we have a baptism here, you need to listen very closely to the language.
Yeah.
You know, marked with the cross of Christ.
Yeah. Mark you as one as both upon your forehead and your heart. Yeah, heart. That's right. Yeah. Very good.
Can I read my footnote?
Please.
Okay, so it says the mark of the beast is designed to mock the seal of that God places on his followers.
I thought just, I made it up.
Just as God marks his people to save them, so Satan beast marks his people to save them from persecution that Satan will inflict upon God's followers. Identifying this particular mark is not as important as identifying the purpose of the mark. Those who accept it show their allegiance to Satan, their willingness to operate within the economic system he promotes, and their rebellion against God. To refuse the mark means to commit oneself entirely to God, preferring death to compromising one's faith.
I think that's a pretty good footnote. I think that's a very helpful way of reading it.
If you don't receive the mark, that means you're following Christ.
Right, right. And to not receive the mark, I think, is to simply say, trust Jesus.
I'm already marked.
Yeah, that's right. You belong to Christ. Yeah. And Tom, I think it was you who brought this up last week. Like, you will not accidentally receive the mark.
I was just going to say that. Yeah, you won't accidentally get the mark.
Yeah, and even then, I mean, like, so let's say we come to, like, the end times and it turns out I was all wrong and it is a barcode on your arm or something like this, and you get one. Does that mean you're beyond the realm of salvation? Absolutely not. Of course not. Like, there's always hope until Christ returns or whatever. But it does mean that if you decide, I'm going to be marked because I reject Jesus, now you're in dangerous water, okay, obviously.
But if it comes down to buying food at the grocery store to feed your family, are you all going to just pray and starve to death?
No, because this is, again, this is what goes back to the church's responsibility to care for one another. Okay. And you huddle together and you start caring for each other. You grow your own food.
Okay.
You do that kind of stuff. I mean, fine. I mean, this stuff, the Lord will provide. He's not going to abandon us, sure. Though it may mean hungry nights, though it may mean persecution. I mean, though it may mean difficult stuff. And I think what's very interesting in your footnote, Sheldon, is where it says that the devil is marking his to, the language was very fascinating because I never heard it worded this way, to save them from the hardship he's going to inflict on the church. And I actually think I really like that, because we like to say God is hidden in suffering and the devil is hidden in glory. I think that's a good way of saying that. That those who, because it's very appealing when you've got the gun to your head to deny Christ, and it makes the devil very happy. Does that make sense? So they say, you know, look, you just have to say Caesar is Lord and I'm not going to hang you on a cross. It's just that simple. I think we read the story of Polycarp. Is it Polycarp? One of the early martyrs. He was like 70 some years old, just living in a house by himself. He was one of the most influential preachers. I think he was a disciple of John, who wrote Revelation. And the Roman soldiers came to his house, and they were like taken aback by how kind and, like, I think he served him coffee, gave him a place to sleep, you know, or served him something to drink. And they were like reasoning with him. They weren't even like, you know, knife to the throat, you'd better do this, or else. It was like, look, if you just say Caesar's Lord, we're not going to kill you. It's just that easy. But we've got a job, and we're going to put you on a cross, or would cover, I think, feed him to the lions if you don't recant. And Polycarp's line is just beautiful. The Lord has not abandoned me these 72 years. I will not abandon him now. Which is great, you know. I mean, that's the heart of these texts here. Not conspiracy theory and what do I need to be aware of in the news and what should I be watching for, and does CNN equal 666 or FOX equals 666, depending on whose time you're on. Boy, I wish we recorded the morning classes sometime, just so I could go home and listen. But none of this, it's kind of peripheral to the real issue of faith or unbelief. And it's an apocalyptic, symbolic way of talking about those things. Are you going to follow Christ, or are you going to bow to the state when it gets hard? That's the real question. Are you going to persevere and suffer for the name of Jesus and die and bear your cross or not? Now, this is easier to hear if you're living in, you know, the Sudan right now, because this is a reality. It's hard to hear when you're going to hop in your car and probably put on the air conditioning because it's a little muggy still, right? I love to tell you I'm ready to give up my comforts for Jesus, but I really like air conditioning. We don't have any concept of what this is. And we are, I won't deny that we're beginning to see hints of animosity toward the church, but we have yet to face this kind of pushback in America. And the complacency is more of the temptation here than the denial. The denial because of complacency, how's that? The denial because of complacency and comfort is more of the persecution here, if we even want to use that language, than being nailed to a cross and fed to lions. I'm not even sure I want to call it persecution in America. I want to call it deception. I think that's probably a better way of speaking. Because I've been wrestling with that for some time. Because we have quite a persecution complex in America for not having our church is attacked by the government. Did you have something?
Well,
go ahead.
I was going to say, to me, it's almost more insidious what's happening.
Sure.
Here.
Yeah. It's. I think so. I think you're right. Yeah.
Frog being boiled by soul eternity.
Yeah, that's right. It's the frog boiling. I think you said that last week too, Dave.
And there might be a point to go this deep because you don't cross that bridge yet, but I know, like you said, okay, if we had to get a mark to go get groceries, we're all going to meet at the church and we're going to plant corn and vegetables, right? At what point are we allowed to defend? Because I know you made a point to me earlier that said, if somebody was coming into my house to rob me and they wanted food, you'd be at the top of the stairs going, you know what, take whatever, you said this to me, you said, take whatever you want, but if you even come near my wife or my children, it's on. You mm-hmm. told me, so I know at some point we draw
like
a line. Mm-hmm.
All right. Yeah, good. It's a good question. in that instance, so breaking into the house, I'm going to give you two scenarios. I think there's two issues at stake here. There's the person breaking into my house to attack my family, and there's the persecution being dragged off for the sake of my faith. When someone comes to attack my family, I have a responsibility from God to protect my family. That's my job as a father and as a husband. It's my calling. And I am faithful to God and my family when I kick that guy out of my house in the face or something like this, right? I don't know what I would do. I'd probably have a toy and Legos on the floor for him or something. I'm not sure yet. That's how I'm going to win this thing. I'm just going to start spilling Legos on the floor at night by the windows. That's not true. I'm just not going to pick up after my kids.
And he's going to trip over and break it.
Yeah, that's right. It's going to be Home Alone. It's going to be great.
Rugrat movie track.
Yeah, that's right. So, I mean, in that instance, yes. Now, the other question then is, someone comes after me for my faith, I say, take me. I turn the other cheek. I follow Christ to the cross, basically.
Okay, I understand that.
But then is what happens when they come for my family? And that's the question I lose sleep over. Go ahead.
Well, thou shalt not kill.
Yeah. Again, okay, so here's...
If you have a shotgun in your hand,
this
you
is great.
Your family to the...
This is a good thing to bring up. The Bible says thou shalt not murder, which is a different thing necessarily than killing. So, for example, what we got to do, I think I do this every 5 months, and I think I want to do it again sometime soon because this came up this morning as well. The state has the responsibility to wield the sword. In other words, the responsibility of the government is to protect its citizens. So if someone comes attacking the citizens so let's say Thousand Oaks tries to take over Moore Park, Mayor Parvin is responsible for making sure we have an army here to protect ourselves. Like, that's her job. That's the state's responsibility so that Moore Park isn't taken over. If it happened. All right. So that's, I mean, in a real sense, when terrorists attack America, the government has a responsibility to go after the terrorists, right? To protect the country. And we say, theologically, the government is an extension of the family. That is to say, we have someone in authority over us because there's a lot of families around and we need one overseeing kind of body to protect us. And so you have a government and they set up an army and they protect you. Now, in my home, I'm the government. And I got a lot of rebels in my house. You should know that. But I'm the government in my house and it's not going great all the time. But if someone attacks my people, I have a responsibility to love my neighbor and protect them from my enemy. In this instance, my neighbor is my wife and my kids. I'm not going to let this person harm my family and say, well, Jesus told me to turn the other cheek, because that's not what he's talking about. In those instances, he's talking about when someone attacks you for your faith or even comes after you as a person. I'm okay saying, I'll go enough of a pacifistic route to say, if someone wants to beat me up, I'll turn the other cheek and say, I forgive you. But if they're coming for my neighbor, now I have a responsibility to my neighbor to protect them. So the bully on the playground needs people surrounding. The kids need to be protected from bullies by their friends. That's a good thing. Go ahead, Tom.
Can I recommend a book that actually should read?
Let me ask you this. Is the author's last name Smith or Young?
No.
Okay, we're good. All right, go ahead. Yeah. Joseph Smith, Brigham Young, never mind. Yeah.
What I was saying, because my children said it, they'll show the kill, right?
Yeah.
C.S. Lewis wrote Mere Christianity during the Second World War, and he got a chance in Mere Christianity to discuss what was going on, you know, in terms of people killing people, okay? That the government... and sends people over to kill people,
Right?
Which is seemingly, you know, we're not supposed to do.
Yeah, right.
Okay, or you can make a case for anything. And I would suggest Mere Christianity. Would not suggest the Great Apostles.
Yeah.
I got a book recommendation in there. In the book.
Good enough. Yeah, read Lewis. Read that one. That's a great book.
Mere Christianity is a great book.
Yeah, it's very good, and you can probably get it for $13, something like that. It's probably pretty
good. On the same note, though, if we didn't take the mark to go get groceries, and the church comes together to plant their own farms, what if the city comes in and tries to take up our crops? Do we defend that?
That's a good question. That's a great question. I think...
I mean, at some point, you got to defend your existence or
yes,
your
here's what I say. Here's what I say. And I know this is going to make me sound just awful, but I say the men line up out in front of all those crops, and the women if they'd like to join them, but the men line up in front of those crops and say, you will come over our dead bodies for those crops, okay, and you defend the crops. You don't necessarily fight, but you protect, and you look over your family, and you care for them, and you deal with the consequences for standing up to the state, for doing your job. I want to be careful, though, too, because we're not in that right now.
Well, I know, but we need to be prepared.
We are prepared, but there's also something to be said for recognizing we can't know what to do in every situation, because as soon as we're prepared for 90 situations, the 91st comes along, and you just don't know. So in other words, there's got to be a level of faith that says the Lord will grant us wisdom how to react when the persecution arises.
Well, the reason we ask you is because you're his vessel.
Right, and that's why I'm saying I'm poor at it because I don't have the answer. So, I think, again, I told you this last week, and I think this verse has given me great comfort in this whole thing, thinking about persecution and hardship and difficulty, is the verse from Jesus which says, in those days you will know what to say because the Holy Spirit will give you what to say. The Spirit will grant us the wisdom necessary to face whatever arises. And again, he will not leave us or forsake us. He's not sitting up there saying, all right, I've been with you this time. Here comes the persecution. I'm out. Let's see if you got it. He's not leaving us or forsaking us. He will not abandon us. We are in the language he uses in John 10, you're in the palm of your Father's hand, and he will not let you go. It's good to keep in mind. And in the context there, it's talking about people coming in to attack the sheep, the thieves coming in to go after the sheep. And Jesus saying, I'm the good shepherd. I'm laying my life down for you. No one can snatch you out of my Father's hand. See, so when those things happen, Christ is not going to forsake us. And it's good to be prepared, but it's also good to know that today is the day to concern ourselves with because we cannot control the future.
He's not going
to
forsake us spiritually. But what I'm saying, we're standing in front of that crop. Do we allow them to mow us over or do we fight back?
I'm telling you, Sheldon, we don't know the answer because we're not there right now. Okay. And I'm saying I'm not going to make up a scenario answer because I just don't know. There's not going to be that much vegetables in this back corner here. It's just, it's not to be too worried about. Yeah, yeah. I just don't, in those days, I think.
You need to have to think about taking a life.
That's right. And I think that you are being distracted then from what the promises are. That something's in your head saying, these are all these things you need to terrify yourself with. And Jesus says, don't worry about tomorrow. Tomorrow will worry about itself. So when the persecution arises, if it arises, and they, you know, we've planted potatoes and they try and take them, we'll deal with it when it comes. But tomorrow's issues are more significant and important than what we do when the persecution arises, because that's the day God has given us. Let's rejoice and be glad in it and serve the neighbor in front of us and not worry about the neighbor 100 years down the road. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does.
Okay.
I don't mean to overthink it.
You're not. You're fine, Jill. You're not doing anything wrong. I'm just letting you know, like, we can't come up with an answer for things we're not going through. We trust the Lord when it arises to provide for us and protect us. Okay. Okay, good. I did get out of doing the 666. Let's do it really quickly, because I think we can. The number. So that no one can buy or sell unless he has the mark, that is the name of the beast, or the number of its name. This calls for wisdom. So your pastor is out. Let the one who has understanding, again, out, calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of man, and his number is 666. Now, Sheldon, you're right on the mark. It's an incomplete number. Why would 6 be considered the number of man?
It falls short of 7.
Yes. Think biblically now. In the Bible, What is the significance of the number 6 and mankind?
The creation.
Creation, 6th day of creation, right? So why is 6 the number of man? Because man was created on the 6th day. But here, the number of man is sort of associated with the beasts and this unholy trinity. And so I think what we have here is this unholy trinity exalting man to the glory of the devil, perhaps, and 666 represents that. Now, ancient Hebrew and Greek use letters of the alphabet to represent numbers. So you guys have the Psalms. If you ever go to Psalm 119, really long psalm, it's broken up. And if you ever notice, there's like weird words at the top of each of the psalm, the way it's broken up in Psalm 119. Those are the Hebrew alphabet. So what is it? Ayin, Gimel, Daleth, something like Aleph, Gimel, Daleth, something like that. So you have the first, those letters of the Hebrew alphabet breaking up the psalm, but you could also see those as the numbers. This is the first part of Psalm 119, second part of Psalm 119. So the Hebrew numbers are used, the Hebrew letters are used for numbers. And there was a practice called Gematria. I'll quiz you on it. You can pronounce it correctly for me. Which says that names could be given numerical value. So you would take the letters of someone's name in Greek or Hebrew, add them up, and you would get a certain number. Okay? And they did this with Nero Caesar. And in Greek, his number equals something like 478,000. I don't forget what it is. I don't know what it is at all. I made that up. But in Hebrew, if you take Caesar's name, Nero Caesar, and you put it into Hebrew letters and add it up, it equals 666. So then everyone says, see, this is talking about Nero Caesar. And, okay, if that's the mark of the first beast, because the first beast is the political power, that makes some sense, okay? But it's a little tricky to say that because, let's see. Caesar had been dead for 20 years at this point, probably, and John's readers wouldn't have really grasped that. So, here's what we want to do. Follow me on this. I'm going to read my notes and then try and explain them clearly. Six is the sixth day of creation, so six equals man. We did that already. Three together represents an unholy three sixes. So it represents the unholy Trinity, which apes the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the dragon and the two beasts. And this unholy Trinity falls short and fails. If we're going to have a holy number, it would be 777. So Sheldon, even your jersey falls short by one. The wisdom called for then is wisdom that God gives, which enables the Christians to know what the unholy Trinity is and what it represents at any given time here on earth. It is a wisdom through which God shows us how the dragon is at work through his beasts. And I would say this, it's a wisdom God gives us by grace in his word. Not a supernatural, well, I mean, I guess we could say it's a supernatural wisdom, but it comes from the word of God. It doesn't come magically upon us. Something like that. It's not a secret Gnostic wisdom. It's you read the word, you see churches preaching against Christ, you see the state pushing against the church, you know the devil's at work. That kind of thing. Does that make sense? Okay. So then, 666 just kind of marks anything that works for the beast and the devils. It is worth noting that in some of the ancient manuscripts, and this always is kind of interesting to think about, the more reliable manuscripts they found, or in some of the more reliable manuscripts they found, the number there written out is 616. So what does that do with all of our theology? I mean, it just says it's on a tailspin. And perhaps there's something more to it than just figuring out what the specific number is. I haven't added up Obama's name yet, so you can all sleep well. It might be Kim Kardashian, I'm not sure.
Whoever
you'd like the least.
Yeah. My King James Version says 603 6.
That sounds like a little speech that a certain Abraham Lincoln gave. I just want to say 466 years ago, I think is what he says. Okay.
But it's the same.
364 is 60.
Yeah, nobody? All right, good. 366. All right. So that this is the one that all the, you know, websites and everyone freak out about, but the point here is the devil will mark his as his own. You belong to Christ. Fear not, little flock, for I am with you. It's the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Okay? Okay. Does anyone have a footnote maybe that might shed some more useful light on that?
Very similar to what you said. Okay. It's a symbol of the unholy Trinity, mm-hmm. and that it falls short by one. Each number falls short.
Yeah. I think that's good. Yeah, I think that's great. Okay. Good. Okay, so now in this vision, we've come now to the end of the attack part. Remember, this is kind of one pattern we've seen through all the visions. Things are really, 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 really bad, and then Jesus shows up and makes things right. And we're about to get to the Jesus showing up part here, okay? And that'll be next week. Good. Outstanding. Thanks, you guys, for working through this tonight. This was good stuff. Let's sing the doxology and go home. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Thanks for listening to this Bible study presentation from Faith Lutheran Church in Moorpark, California. We hope this has helped you grow in your Christian faith and study of the Bible. For more information, visit us on the web at faithmoorpark.com.
Music by Kevin MacLeod.